So we are back for this second talk on this arithmeticity theorem that I stated at the end of the first talk. And this arithmeticity theorem tells you that if I have a Zariski-Dance discrete subgroup of a semi-simple group in higher rank, which contains co-compact lattice of some orospherical group, then it has to be arithmetic. This is a statement. As I told you, I will spend this lecture to begin the proof for SL4R and the unipotent group which is above. In fact, I will spend the remaining talk speaking about this example, which is, but I forgot to give credits about this theorem. First, that's a remark about the general theorem. You see, the point of this theorem is that you don't assume a priori that gamma is a lattice. It's just a discrete group. So when gamma is a lattice, this theorem is Margulis first arithmeticity theorem. So Margulis has proven four arithmeticity theorem, and the first one is for non-co-compact lattice that he wrote completely, and then he found a completely different proof using much more ergodic theory, and which will work for any lattice, co-compact or not co-compact. This is the second Margulis arithmeticity theorem. And so this result is exactly the first arithmeticity theorem, except, so when Margulis was proving his first arithmeticity theorem, he proved the first step, that he knew that if you have a lattice, it will be Zariski-Dance. He knew, but he improved his result with Cashdan, proving that when you have such a lattice which is not co-compact, it will intersect co-compactly orospherical subgroup. And then he went on the proof, and but going on the proof, he still used at some points the fact that gamma is a lattice. But he felt that maybe starting from that point, he might not need it. So he asked the question whether one could do it. And he asked it in particular to EO as a PhD question, and she managed to do many cases in her PhD. So this theorem is due to EO in many cases. I will not say which cases, not. But I will explain what are the differences in the proof, which allow me to, which allow us to do all cases. But many cases, including all the cases where G is SLDR. So it was for non-split, not real split groups that the problem occurred in the strategy she followed. But as you see, I plan to give you a proof for SL4R, which is a case covered by Hio. But I will follow a proof which is not her proof, but a proof that can easily be generalized to any semi-simple group. If I explain for SL4R, it's to have less notation. Just okay. Okay, so this is for the historical comments, and now I'm going to prove this theorem for SL4A. Maybe restate it for SL4A. Let me restate the theorem. So that's what is here. I'm starting with the group SL4A and this unipotent subgroup. And you see, by Zariski density, I am able to find some G0 in my group gamma. Gamma is Zariski dense. I'm able to find which will take your unipotent group U and put it in an opposite way, so that I will be able to find the basis for which this group G0 U G0 minus 1 will be exactly the group of lower triangular matrices of this shape. So, conjugating by G0 my group delta, I get a lattice in U minus. So this way, I have a lattice in U and I have a lattice in U minus. And it's a rephrasing of the theorem. Now you have a very concrete question. You have U, U minus, a lattice in U, a lattice in U minus. And the theorem is if the group gamma, which is the group spanned by these two lattices, is discrete, that's the assumption. I have a group isomorphic to Z4 above, but I don't know how this Z4 is embedded in U. I have a group isomorphic to Z4 down. I don't know how it is embedded there. The only assumption is that the group they span as a subgroup of SL4R is a discrete subgroup of G. And then the conclusion is that then gamma is arithmetic. Then gamma is commensurable to some GZ for some Q form of G. Okay? So this is what I plan to prove. And so I give a name to this second lecture. Maybe I should have given it. It's a closeness of the orbit. And because I will not prove this theorem today, I will just prove that some orbit is closed, and tomorrow I will explain how the fact that you know that the orbit is closed implies that the gamma is arithmetic. And today it will be very elementary. So, which orbit? Okay. So, you see, this problem is invariant under the group which normalizes both U and U minus. So it's very natural to introduce the normalizer to U and U minus. This is L. Which is a set of diagonal matrices. G. And this group L contains L0, which is those matrices for which both of them have determinant 1. This group is isomorphic to SL2R cross SL2R. In what I will explain, you can replace 4 by 2 times d, and you will have SLDR cross SLDR. There will be no difference. So you have this nice group, which is a product of SL2R cross SL2R, and it acts by conjugation on U and U minus. On U. The matrix B is sent to AB D minus 1. And U is, you can identify U with the 2 by 2 matrices with a real coefficient. So this is a natural action of SL2R cross SL2R on the 2 matrices with real coefficient. So it's an action of SL2R cross SL2R in some vector space of dimension 4. So and L0 acts also on U minus, which is also M2R, but the action is slightly different. And but also you see the data I have is a lattice in U. And a lattice in U minus. So I can choose the R measure on U so that this lattice has covolume 1. So L0, I introduce that X of U is a set of lattices of covolume 1 in U, and X of U minus is a set of lattices of covolume 1 in U minus. And the group L0 acts on this space of lattices, and it acts also here. So what maybe I have not... So both of them are, those are lattices in 4-dimensional space, so of covolume 1. So both of them are the group SL4R, which acts on the space of dimension 4, and the stabilizer of a lattice is SL4Z. So what you see here is that this group, which has dimension 3 plus 3, which is 6, acts on a space, SL4 is of dimension 15, on a space of dimension 15, which has a finite volume. By, we have seen this by Minkowski. And the problem we are asking is invariant under conjugation by L0. So if it is true for a couple delta, delta minus, it will be true for all the couples in the L0 orbit. So it's a question of L0 orbit. And the key step, key proposition, first, it will tell you that the L0 orbit L0 delta, this delta, the delta which is a lattice for which there is some delta minus, for which the they span a discrete subgroup of G. So the L0 orbit of this L0 delta is closed. Uh, And the second point is that it's also true for the double orbit, meaning if you act diagonally in the product space, the L0 orbit L0 applied to the couple delta delta minus is closed in the product space XU cross XU minus. So L0 is a semi-simple group. It's SL2 cross SL2. I will check that its orbit, two orbits he has in this finite volume homogeneous space are closed. This is what I will do today. Okay? Maybe just right now for 1 minute, I will explain how I will use it tomorrow. So the argument for tomorrow is that since we are dealing with orbit of a semi-simple group in a space of finite volume, the fact that an orbit is closed implies that, in fact, it's the orbit itself has finite volume. The only way orbit is closed is to a finite volume, if you are in a space of finite volume. It's true for semi-simple groups, so we will see that tomorrow. Once we know that the orbit has finite volume, since L0 is not compact, this means I will be able to find elements which normalize delta and delta minus. So allowing me to add this element to delta and delta minus, I will be able to add element. In the normalizer of gamma, I will be able to have element which in fact are in L. So I will be allowed to enlarge gamma. Going to the normalizer might be a strange thing, but there is an exercise in the list of exercises. Is that if you have a discrete Zariski dense group like that, its normalizer is still discrete Zariski dense. So for this bigger group, you not only have elements in U and U minus, but also many elements in L. And this will help you to go on. And I will explain that tomorrow. So now I want to explain how you prove that this orbit is closed. Are there questions? So I repeat, I want to prove this, and today I just prove this. Yes?
Can you explain again how this theorem is a special case of the
above? So, yes, I can. So instead of semi-simple group, I take SL4R, and instead of U, I take this U here. Here above, you have just one. Your question is maybe here I have just one unipotent, and how do you get from one to two unipotents? This is here by Zariski density. You see, there is an assumption here that gamma is Zariski dense. Okay? So gamma is Zariski dense, so you are able, you see, U is a stabilizer of some R2 in R4. It stabilizes some R2 in R4. So if you choose an element G0 in gamma, for which this R2 becomes to a complementary R2, what you get is that the conjugate group U in a suitable basis will be just written as lower diagonal matrices like here. But then the conjugate of delta by this element of gamma, all this stay in gamma. So now you, starting from this group there, you see that it intersects U minus in this, at least in this delta minus, so at a lattice. So gamma contains this group here. But when you have a group gamma which contains, if you take the conclusion here, you have this lattice. We know it's a lattice. If you have a gamma, a discrete group which contains a lattice, then it is itself a lattice. Yeah. So that's the way. Thank you. So now we forget about all these words. So what is the strategy of proof? The second part of this lecture. Of the key proposition there. So I will state two lemmas. I need some notation, and I will try to keep, I'm working with SL for R, but you see I want to keep the notation kind of general, because I think it helps to understand better the proofs than giving to specialize too much. So the first notation is to decompose the Lie algebra G. G is the Lie algebra of SL for R matrices. Of SL4R, so it's 4 by 4 matrices with 0 trace. And you can decompose it as U minus plus L plus U. The part which is elements which are just in the lower left block, the diagonal blocks, and the upper right block. And when I have, so I write pi. There is a trick which, when I will act on the Lie algebra, I will just keep the part in U. Okay, so I need a notation for that, which is having pi, the projection from G to U, the projection. This is the projection whose kernel is U minus plus L. I just keep this part. And the notation is for G in G. I introduce M of G, which is pi at G pi, which is an anomorphism of U. Let me write it what it is. I'm just writing the adjoint of G. In this decomposition, U minus L U, as a block matrices. Now you see, I'm dealing with 15 by 15 matrices, okay? I'm in the Lie algebra, okay? This is 4, 7, 4. So this is the U minus, this is the L, this is the U. And I just keep this M of G. This is this block. I extract this block. Okay, and I need another notation. I need to introduce omega, which is the open Bruassel. We have this in the exercise sheet, which is the product U minus LU. All matrices that can be written as a product of an element of U minus of L and U. And I will say it very soon that those you can describe this open set, it's a Zariski open set that you can describe easily. So let's define this, omega. And let me write the lemma. I want to. What do I need? I prefer to keep this. we don't need the general theorem anymore. So this lemma 1 is that with M of G, I will be able to construct a family of matrices, and it, what I'm saying, it will be a discrete set of matrices. And more precisely, the statement is, if I'm considering all the M of G applied to X, where G is in gamma, in my discrete group, and but also in omega. For some technical reason, I have to assume it is in omega. It can be written U minus LU. It's not very important because it's an open set, Zariski open set. What I remove is a higher dimensional. And where X is in the lattice, lambda. So I have to say what is lambda. Lambda will be the logarithm of delta. You see, U can be identified with its Lie algebra. There is the exponential map, and the other map is the logarithm. I call it the logarithm. So it's a very easy map because those are isomorphic to R4. And the map is, if I have 0, b, 0, b, sorry, 0, b, 0, 0, the exponential of that is 1, b, 0, 1. And the logarithm of 1, b, 0, 1 is 0, b, 0, 0, okay? And I have delta is a lattice here. I get a lattice here. This is delta, okay? So now the statement is that if I apply the matrices to all the elements of the lattice, I get elements in U is a closed discrete subset of this vector space. This vector space is four-dimensional. So it's a tricky statement.
I'm kind of confused about MG.
MG, okay. So the adjoint matrix of G is a 15 by 15 matrix.
Right.
Because it's a matrix in the an endomorphism of the Lie algebra, which is 15 dimensional. But this 15 dimensional Lie algebra has been decomposed as something which is 4 dimensional, 7 and 4 dimensional.
Yeah.
Okay. And this matrix, I can write it as a block matrix.
Right.
And I extract the block on U. I just take this block.
But then you write it as pi at G.
Pi, yes. Pi is a map from G to U. I'm kind of maybe I'm thinking of the endomorphism of U. Okay. As a subset of the endomorphism of G,
right,
where I put zero everywhere except here. This is what I'm doing. You're right, there is a little thing there. Okay? So, how will I use that? I mean, I can tell you how I will use it, and then it will be easy. So, if, maybe here, that's the trick I will use in the computation. If G is V, L U, in this decomposition, U minus L U, okay, what will be M of G? By construction, U will not contribute to M of G. And V will not contribute to M of G. So it will just depend on L. And it will just be the adjoint of L, restricted to U. So this is the way I will use it. So those are easy exercises with matrices. U is an upper triangular matrix, okay? So when you look at it, it's the adjoint representation. It will be also upper triangular matrix. And V is a lower triangular matrix. So in the adjoint representation, it will be lower triangular. That's why you have this formula. So this is the lemma one. And what is the lemma two? So I define a polynomial, phi of G, which is the determinant in U of M of G. That's a polynomial in G. And the lemma 2 is it will be a consequence of lemma 1. Let me write all the lemmas. I just have two lemmas. Okay. From the first lemma, I will deduce another lemma, which is that the set phi of gamma so all the determinant of this matrix is M of G when G describes my discrete group gamma, phi of gamma is a closed discrete subset of R. Now, the strategy of the proof is easy. First, prove lemma 1. Second, prove lemma 2, deduce from lemma 1 and lemma 2. And third, explain how lemma 2 implies the point A of the K proposition and point B of the K proposition. Okay? Okay. Let me speed up a little bit. Okay. Are there questions about the lemma I want to prove? Maybe you need time to. So I'm doing the proof of lemma 1. Sorry?
What does correspond G, mg of in a general semi-simple degree group?
Ah, exactly the same form, same definition. You decompose G as U minus L is the intersection of the normalizer of P and normalizer of U and normalizer of U minus. This is defined in general, and so you have the decomposition U minus plus L plus U, and you choose that. So it works pretty well in all cases where U is commutative, abelian. When it is not abelian, you have a method to reduce general case to either abelian or Heisenberg case. So you have some cooking, some recipe. But for the abelian case, you follow exactly this argument. No change. So let me prove of lemma 1. I want to prove that this set of matrix this set of elements of U is a discrete set. And so you see in the definition I said closed discrete, I did not say just discrete. For a group it's the same, a discrete group is always closed. You see, if you look at the set 1 over n in R, it's a discrete set, but it's not a closed discrete set. Okay, so closed discrete set is, I have to add it when it's not a group. So let me prove lemma one. So I start with element in this set. Let x prime n equal m of gn xn. So in my set, and assume it converges for n infinity to x prime infinity. So with the proof is quite short, in fact. Both proof of lemma 1 and lemma 2 are quite short. So with gn, gn is in omega. You can write it vn ln un. Xn, so, and in gamma. And xn is in lambda. And under this assumption, I want that x prime n is equal to x prime infinity for n large. So I may assume all of them are distinct, extracting, and I want a contradiction if you want. So let's try to prove that. So the idea is that this Vn is in u minus, but maybe I can make them converge because I have a lattice here. So let's write Vn equal delta n minus 1 v prime n with delta n in delta minus and v prime n converges. So I recall that this element is in u minus, this element is in L, this element is in U. So, and it converges to some element in U minus. Okay. So I write this, and the only trick is to compute one element of gamma, a sequence of elements of gamma well chosen that will converge. So this element of gamma is the following. Compute this element of gamma, let's call it gamma n, which is maybe delta n gn e to the xn, exponential of xn. Xn is in lambda, meaning the exponential is in delta. So I'm conjugating this element by gn and using the delta n to make it converge. Okay? So I'm just computing this. And then when you compute this conjugation, many things will disappear. Because the delta n will cancel with the vn. So you get that it is v prime n. And then you get the ln. But since the group u is commutative, here you have a conjugate of e to the xn by this un. So it will disappear. The un disappears. So you get e to the xn ln minus 1 v prime n minus 1, which is v prime n. And then you get the exponential of add ln xn v prime n minus 1, which is this element above, which is mgn of xn. So what you get here is this element x prime n. So what you get is v prime n e to the x prime n v prime n minus 1, and you know that it converges to v prime infinity e to the x prime infinity v prime infinity minus 1. Let me keep it here. Let me go on the proof here. So you have a sequence of elements in a discrete group which converge to one element. So it has to be constant. Then v prime n e x prime n v prime n minus 1 is equal to v prime infinity e to the x prime infinity v prime to the infinity minus 1 for n large. But then these elements xn are upper triangular, they are above, and you conjugate them by lower triangular matrices and you get the same. So this implies that in fact x prime n is equal to x prime infinity. You just take the block in U, the part in U, you apply pi, if you want. You apply pi to the expression, you get x prime n here, x prime infinity here. So we have proven lemma 1. I have 15 minutes left. Are there questions for the proof of lemma 1? So let me give the proof of lemma 2. I have to keep everything, so maybe I erase above, yeah. So I want to prove that this set of determinants is a closed discrete subset of R. So I start like in the proof of lemma 1. I start with let phi of gn converge to n to something phi infinity with Gn in gamma. And I want to prove that phi of Gn is in fact equal to phi infinity for n large. So what you do is you look at these lattices. So mgn of lambda. So You assume that, so this is a real number. You assume that it's not the case, that it's not constant. So you assume they are all different. So they will be all non-zero. And when they are non-zero, this implies that the gn will be in omega. So So then when you look at the lattices M of Gn lambda by lemma 1, the union of these lattices, those are lattices in R4, in this U, which is dimension 4. So the union of all these lattices is a discrete set, is a closed discrete set. So what happens, so imagine you are in, instead of R4, you are in R2. You have a family of lattices in R2, and a sequence of lattices in R2. And you know that the union of all these lattices is a discrete set. So what can happen is that these lattices, maybe they go away. Everything disappears. Or maybe one vector still remains there, and then in the other direction, it goes away. But here, this cannot happen, because these phi of Gn are this determinant. Those are the covolume of the lattices. So the lattices have bounded covolume. They have bounded covolume, and they live in a discrete set. So after extraction, you can make them converge. This is Mahler criterion. Which tells you that how do you describe the compact subset in the set of lattices? You must not have small vectors inside your lattices, and the covolume has to be bounded. So what I'm saying is that if you look at this sequence of matrices, one can assume, extracting the sequence M of Gn lambda converge to some lambda infinity after extraction, to some lattice. Maybe after extraction. But how can a sequence of lattice converge to a lattice? It's if the union is a discrete set, it has to be constant. So, and if this sequence of lattice is constant, the covolume are constant. This is what I wanted. Okay, so this proof lemma 2.
So what do you mean by extraction?
You see you have extraction, you say extracting a subsequence. You know, when you have assume you are in the real number R, if you have you have a bounded set minus A. If you have a sequence of bounded elements in the real, it does not converge. But you are always able to find a subsequence which converges. And this, all this process, I just sum it up as after extraction. So, now I want to explain how lemma 2 implies a key proposition. But before, to be concrete, I want to be concrete what is exactly this polynomial phi of g, which seems complicated. So to be concrete, if I take a matrix these are also in the exercise sheet. If the matrix G is just block matrices, AG, BG, CG, DG, if you take 2x2 matrices, what is U minus LU? This is one exercise. How do you recognize the matrix that you can write it as a product of a lower triangular of this shape, block diagonal and block upper triangular? Those are exactly the matrices G in G for which this matrix, this block is invertible. So that's the way to recognize omega. And how do you compute M of G? So you know that U is isomorphic to M2 of R, a matrix X which is 0, B, 0, 0 correspond to a matrix B. And then what is M of G X? What does it correspond to? So it's a matrix 0, 0, 0, and you have something here. What do you have for the B? And you do the computation, and you find AG, B, and DG minus 1. So you multiply B on the left by the coefficient A of the matrix G, and you multiply on the right by the coefficient D of the matrix G minus 1. This is how what is this M of G? So we know exactly what is M of G, so maybe we can compute the determinant of this transformation. So phi of G, you can be very explicit. It is the determinant of, you are acting in a four-dimensional space. So it is, and AG is a 2x2 matrix. So this will be the determinant of AG to the square times the determinant of DG minus 1 to the square. But you have in your exercise sheet the fact that those two have same determinant. So that's the determinant of AG to the 4. So there is a very easy formula for phi of G. Okay? So from that I get the following corollary. Corollary, the set of determinant of B maybe okay the set now I will yeah for which the matrix 0 B 0 0 is in lambda. Is a closed discrete subset of R. Maybe I call it. Maybe I will not write it like that. Okay, I don't like it. F of X. What is f of x? F of x will be phi of e to the x g0. And you can check that this is equal up to some constant to the determinant of b to some power 4 when x is this guy, 0, b, 0, 0. Is a closed discrete subset of R. So what have I done? I have 1 minute. What I have done is I have taken this polynomial phi. This polynomial phi is the determinant of this matrix. But I want to restrict this polynomial to u. So it's not good, it's just 1. So what I do is I move it by g0. g0 is this matrix here. We change up and down. So it takes the b, you put it exactly on the left, upper right left block. And so when I compute phi at e to the x g0, I just get this determinant of b. And so if I apply lemma 2, I get a subset of this closed discrete set, which is exactly the f of x for x in the lattice. And I know it's a closed discrete subset of R. Okay? And f of x is very easy, it's just a determinant of b. So now I want to prove a key proposition. How do you get how do you get that this orbit is closed from this information? Okay, I want to prove that this orbit is closed. So I take sequence of elements in the orbit. So let Ln in L0 such that if I'm computing the image of delta by Ln, Ln delta converge. That's the adjoint action on U and then on the lattices in U converge to n infinity to so to delta. Maybe I use lambda. Yeah. Lambda and delta are the same. You go from lambda to delta, it's an exponential map. I erased it. Lambda is delta, is equal to delta, but seen in the Lie algebra. So I'm assuming that I want to prove that the orbit of lambda is closed. So I'm assuming I have a sequence of elements in the orbit going to lambda infinity. And I want to prove that lambda infinity, in fact, is in the orbit. A priori, it converges, and I want to prove it is in the orbit. So what do? I write ln of lambda as phi n of lambda. And where phi n, Ln is an element of SL2 cross SL2 acting in a four-dimensional space. So, and he's pushing this lattice to some lattice. But maybe Ln goes to infinity. But since these lattices are going to this one, I can go from one to the other by an element of a 4x4 matrix, an element of SL4R. Which is going to identity. And what I want to say is that for n large, in fact, this phi n are in L0. But I just know that this phi n are in SL4. So how will I get that they are in L0? I pick a point. So phi n of lambda infinity. This sequence converges to lambda infinity. So they are, this sequence of lattices converges to lambda infinity. They are image of lambda infinity by small matrices. How do I prove that? I compute for every x in lambda infinity. I compute, I'm able to find x is the limit for n infinity of ln add ln xn with xn is in lambda. But maybe xn is going to infinity, ln is going to infinity. But what I do is I compute f of x, or maybe f of phi n of x. So this element is phi n of x. Near any element of lambda infinity, it is some phi n of x going to it. And this phi n of x is in ad ln lambda. So it can be written ad ln xn. So I compute f of x, f of phi n of x. But remember, if you think of x as a 2 by 2 matrix, this polynomial, yes, f is just the determinant. F is the determinant. F is the determinant. So when I compute f of phi n of x, which is f of ad ln of xn, this is the determinant is invariant by ad ln is just multiplying on the left and on the right by a matrix of determinant 1. So you don't change the determinant. It's equal to f of xn. So it belongs to f of lambda, which is discrete. By lemma 2. So, but this converge to f of x. It's a sequence in a discrete set which converges to something. Then f of phi n of x is equal to f of x for n large. So for every x in lambda infinity, I have proven that you have this equality for n large. But then you can exchange. So then you get that you are able to find to prove that for n large, it's very easy to exchange. You get that for all x in lambda infinity, f of phi n x is f of x. So what do you have? You have, so this is in lambda infinity, but then you will get it by Zariski density true for every x in U. So U is a set of 2 by 2 matrices. You have a linear transformation of 2 by 2 matrices, which has the property that when you apply it to a 2 by 2 matrix, it keeps the determinant. The determinant will not change. The only matrices which are doing that are multiplication on the right and multiplication on the left by element of SL2. So this implies that phi n is in L0, which is SL2R cross SL2R. So which is what you wanted, and now you know that your orbit, the single orbit is closed. The orbit of L0 in x of u. I'm out of time a little bit. And for B, you do exactly the same. B is exactly the same as in A. And if you want to know more, there are notes of this course on my web page with the exercise sheet. And well, you will be able to find details for the case B, but there is no other idea than doing the same, introducing a polynomial maybe in U cross U minus, which will be for B, use instead of F, you use the polynomial G of X Y, which is phi of e to the X e to the Y. And you do the same argument. Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you.